everyone. In this video, I'll walk you through a simple example on how you can calculate the derivative of a sigmoid function and why is a particular format of the sigmoid function used in deep learning. So let's get started. I'm assuming everyone's aware of what a sigmoid function is. The sigmoid function is defined as 1 by 1 plus e to the power minus x. The sigmoid function is widely used in algorithms such as logistic regression, and it also finds a special place in deep learning algorithms. Let's visualize the sigmoid function. This is how the sigmoid function looks like. It is an S-shaped curve wherein the values of y, that is your output, range from 0 to 1. Now let's proceed to the main task that we have assigned for this video, which is to find out the derivative of the sigmoid function. The first step before we find out the derivative is to find out what type of rule of differentiation we can apply to the given sigmoid function. As you can clearly see, you have a numerator term in the sigmoid function, which is 1, and you have a denominator term in the sigmoid function, which is 1 plus e to the power minus x. When you try to find out the derivative of a term having a numerator and denominator, we have something called as a quotient rule for our rescue. The way you find out the derivative of a fraction having a numerator and denominator using a quotient rule is, you take the denominator term, multiply it by the derivative of the numerator with respect to x, and store it as the first term of your numerator. You subtract the first term of the numerator that you've just computed with the multiplication of the numerator term as it is into the derivative of the denominator's term. That is what the second term implies here. And you divide this term that you've just computed by taking the difference of the two terms by something called as the denominator square terms. Now it may look daunting, but this is kind of a very simple example that will help you understand how quotient rule is implemented and how you can find out the derivative of the sigmoid function as well. Let's keep the quotient rule as the headline so that you can always refer back to the quotient rule while we differentiate our sigmoid function. This is what we want to differentiate, and then we apply the quotient rule. Going by what I have specified on the top, I pick the denominator as it is. In our case, the denominator was 1 plus e to the power minus x. I save it as it is. I multiply this term with the derivative of my numerator with respect to x. Now my numerator is 1. Derivative of a constant with respect to x is 0 is what I get here. Something similar is what I do in the second part of the numerator term, which is I copy the numerator as it is, that is 1, and if I differentiate the denominator with respect to x, the constant term is 0 and e to the power minus x will be e to the power minus x with a negative sign, which is what I get here, and I square the denominator term. After applying the quotient rule, I am left with this equation. So the derivative of sigmoid function essentially is e to the power minus x upon 1 plus e to the power minus x the whole square. Going through a lot of literature, you wouldn't find this implementation that commonly used because of certain reasons. So we'll try to modify this derivative that we've just computed for the sigmoid function in a format that becomes very easy for computation when we actually implement a neural network. So the next thing that I do is I safeguard the derivative that I've already computed so that you can always refer it as we move along. Now to bring it in a form that we can use easily when we create neural networks is, we start off by adding and subtracting 1 to the numerator. Going by the principles of numerator and denominator addition subtraction, if you add and subtract a term from the numerator, it wouldn't change the fraction at all. So I add and subtract 1 from the numerator and this is what I get. Once I've reached this position, I'll basically split my fraction into two equivalent fractions that add up to this. What I do next is I try to separate out a fraction into its constituents. So I take this 1 and this e to the power minus x and store it as something like this, which is visible from the first term, which is 1 plus e to the power minus x divided by 1 plus e to the power minus x the whole square. I'm left with this minus 1 term which comes here. So my second term of the equation is minus 1 divided by 1 plus e to the power minus x the whole square. Why am I doing this? Will all be clear as we move along. So now that we've done this, let's go to the next step. I start off with again the point that I left in my previous slide. As you can clearly see, these two terms are literally the same, but the denominator is squared version of the numerator. So what I do is I reduce the power of the denominator by 1. So this is cancelled and I'm just left with 1 upon 1 plus e to the power minus x minus 1 upon 1 plus e to the power minus x the whole square, which is this term. Now, the next thing that I do is I take this term as it is and I remove whatever is common within inside a bracket. What I mean to say by that is I have 1 upon 1 plus e to the power minus x outside into 1 minus, that is this term as it is, minus 1 upon 1 plus e to the power minus x. If you look closely, we started off with a sigmoid function s of x, which was 1 upon 1 plus e to the power minus x. So essentially, after doing all of these small manipulations, we have reached to the derivative form of the sigmoid function, which is of the form s of x into 1 minus s of x. Now you might be wondering, why have we done so much of manipulation? In deep learning, what you do is you implement a neural network. The first pass is the forward pass wherein your activations are calculated. And since I have s of x, which is the activation of my previous layer's output, all of these values are stored as a matrix. In order to start with backpropagation or update the weights of my existing layers, what I essentially have to do is whatever weights are existing for that layer, I have to add a minus 1 to it and multiply it with the value of that particular activation itself. So there isn't any complex calculation involved when I use sigmoid as my activation function, because the gradient that we've calculated is essentially the function itself multiplied by 1 minus the function value itself. So that is the uniqueness that this representation gives us. So architecturally, what we can do is we can store the forward propagation results into a cache memory, and while updating the weights, we can directly access the values from the cache memory and update the weights fast, because we've represented the derivative form of the sigmoid function using the values itself. So this is the uniqueness of representing the sigmoid function the way I've represented it. And if you plot the sigmoid function's derivative, this is how it appears.
I hope you found the video informative. If you do have any questions with what we covered in this video, then feel free to ask in the comment section below and I'll do my best to answer those. If you enjoy these tutorials and would like to support them, then the easiest way is to simply like the video and give it a thumbs up. And also, it's a huge help to share these videos with anyone whom you think would find them useful. Please consider clicking the subscribe button to be notified for future videos. And thank you so much for watching the video.